Liquitex acrylic inks are water-based, highly pigmented colorants. Far more fluid than regular acrylic paint, these inks are like very intense watercolors with one important difference. They're permanent once dry. Today we're going to explore a few of the many ways that we can use these inks. The acrylic ink line includes 30 colors. They're all light, fast, water-based, and they're intermixable with each other. And they're also intermixable with other Liquitex or other water-based paint products. Some of them are transparent, some of them are more pigmented and tend to be opaque. This is one of the four iridescents in the line, and if you look closely, you can see that there's pigment settled in the bottom of the jar, and while there's no mixing ball in there, it doesn't take long if you just sort of swish this bottle around. Eventually that pigment will loosen off the bottom, and then you're ready to go. They all come with eyedroppers inside like this, and so you can just put them. This is a nonstick craft sheet that covers my work table. You can put them on one of these well type containers, or you can put them on a palette pad. These colors are very, very highly pigmented. This is some that I picked up with some water in my flat brush and just kind of spread it across the page here, and a little goes a long way. If you think of them as kind of watercolors on steroids, that's a really good analogy. Because they're so fluid and ink-like, they are easy to thin with water and they're going to flow very freely to begin with. And you can certainly add a little bit more water and you can get the colors to flow some more. Now let me just show you. I've got water off camera and I'm going to wet my brush. I'm going to pick up some of this green. I think this is Vivid Lime Green or something like that. And you see how easy it is to get nice coverage, and I can come back and I can wet my brush and I can kind of thin this paint out as I go along. Now one of the really cool things, and let me reach to just grab another brush, one of the really cool things that you can do is you can layer colors without getting mud, and I think that that's really important. One of the things that I think makes mixed media art, journal pages, those kinds of things far more interesting is when you have multiple layers so that you're not looking at sort of a flat, non-dimensional piece. So I've got this green and this blue already on here, and I'm going to come back with this orange color and I can layer it over the top, and you can see that the color is layering, but it is not in fact mixing and muddying with that green that's underneath. It's a true layer. You can see that my brush strokes are here from that first layer that I put on, and they haven't moved because they're permanent when they're dry. And I think that that's super important because it allows us the opportunity to do some very interesting things. You can use them like paint. They are in fact paint, so that's certainly one way that you can think to use them. I have three colors. Again, I have this sort of well, and you can see that I've already come in. These were stamped with Stazon. You could use archival. So long as the color won't bleed when you get it wet, then you're in good shape. All I'm going to do is wet my brush a little bit. Now you can use them straight from the bottle for a really intense color, or you can lighten them up a little bit if you want, and the color will be not quite so intense. Now my brush is wet, and I picked up some of this color, but you can see how deep it is. This is really, really cool, which means not only do you get this nice intense color, but if you thin it with water because you're looking for more of a wash, then a little bit goes a really long way. Now this is just kind of the barest beginnings of the things that we can do with these inks, but if you think of them to start with as a paint, then of course the most natural thing to do is to pick up a brush and start applying them to a surface like this. But again, that's really just the beginning. Let's talk for a moment about using the acrylic inks as a watercolor wash. And this is really fun because you can get them to mix while they're wet, or you can let them a layer dry and apply another over the top, and of course you won't move that first layer. I have just a piece of 90-pound watercolor paper. I'm going to spritz this with water because I do want there to be some movement. Again, I want that watercolor effect, which is going to involve some bleeding. So I've got three or four colors out in my well here, and I'm going to wet a brush, and I'm going to just use the corner to pick up some of the color, and I'm going to put it out. Again, my surface is covered with a nonstick craft sheet, so it acts very much like a palette, and I can use it to put my color down on as I'm going along here. I'm just going to put a little bit of color out. I'm going to let the water sort of wick it out for me and let that cool patterning happen. Get a little bit more water out here. Now I'm looking for very translucent, loose coloring. If you want more color, of course, what you can do is just go ahead and add more, or excuse me, add less water or more color to your surface as you work. I'm going to pick up another color now. This is a sort of a deeper greenish blue. That's a little bit dark for what I want, so I'm just going to thin it with some water. And I'm going to come in and I'm going to apply it around and over what I've already got here so I get some pretty blending going on. And you can imagine this as the background of a journal page. Think of how cool this would be. Next, I'm going to come back. I'm going to just sort of clean some of that greenish blue color out of my brush. I'm going to leave it wet, and I'm going to pick up, this is diazinine purple. It's a really, really deep, intense color. So I'm going to go with far more water here so I don't get too much on too soon. I can always thin this out a little bit if I need to, but it's better to not have to make that giant effort. It's really easier to come in with a lighter color and then add some over the top if you need to. And you can see, again, I'm just kind of letting this color flow on here rather loosely, kind of letting it do its thing. And I've got a corner here that's starting to dry a little bit. So what I can do is spritz it with water, and you see what happens, how this starts to react. And that's cool, but what's going to be even cooler is when I come back in a moment with some salt. And this is Jacquard's Silk Salt. And I'm going to, again, I need to mist this a little bit. This needs to be wet for this to happen with the Silk Salt. But you can see how you get that spotting going on, which is a really cool technique in and of itself. So here's some of the Silk Salt. I'm just going to put some out in my hand and then start sprinkling it in various areas. And this is going to create some really cool patterning and bursts as it reacts with the water that's on this paper. And I'll put this to one side and let it dry. And of course, I'll take a photo so that you can see what this looks like. But again, you can do this to your journal pages. You can use this on the background of a card if you really wanted to for some really cool effects. I can use the acrylic inks and water on the page to create a different kind of background, the one that we just did, and I want to actually show you two things in one as we go along here. One of them will be how to do this, but the other will be when you have color in your well-type palette like this, it's silly to let it dry up. Obviously, it's not like a watercolor because it's going to be permanent when it's dry. It's not like you can put some water in here. I mean, this is already dried up, but I can't reactivate this because it is permanent when it's dry. So let's talk about both of those things. I'm going to start by wetting my watercolor paper, and I'm going to do this in a journal page as a spread for you in one second too, but I wanted to sort of show you on this flat surface to begin with. I have a fair amount of water on the paper, but there are places where there's a little bit less. So let's start with this wild lime green. It's called Vivid Lime Green, and again, I'm going to shake this so that when I work with what's in the bottle, I've moved all the pigment off of the bottom of the bottle. I did that before I put it in the well. So if I were cleaning up, I would come in and I would squeeze everything out of the eyedropper, and I would come to the well and suck it up inside the eyedropper so that I wouldn't be wasting any. But rather than put it back in the bottle, watch what happens when I drop it on that page. How cool is that? The way this is watercolor paper, the way the color wicks out so amazingly from the areas. Oops, see, now there was no water there, so you get no wicking. Let's come in and wet it, and now I get not only wicking, but as the droplets sprayed across the page, the color moves according to how the droplets moved. So that's really, really cool. Now I'm going to actually come in and I am going to re-wet this a little bit more. And I'll come in. This color is Cerulean Blue Hue. And there's only a little tiny bit left in my well palette, but I am going to pick it up. And then I'm going to take some and I'm going to drop it on the page. Now again, this is a little bit more different. This is a little bit more of an opaque color, so it's going to react a little bit differently. There was also less water here. But again, you get this really cool process that's going on as these colors move across the page depending on how wet it is and how intense the color is when you put it on there. Again, I'm not even going to try to pronounce this. It's something green blue shade. I'll put it on the website so that you can see it on a picture of this. And again, we get this crazy bleeding that goes on. I can add more water. I can cause it to kind of spritz and bleed and do all kinds of really cool things. I can put a drop up here. I can see that there's a little puddle of water right there. And again, we get that really cool process that happens. Now, not does it happen that way. If I pick this up and move this, of course, now I'm going to get all kinds of cool things happening as this color moves across the page and it hits the water and it wicks. Let me move this out of the way. Let me grab some paper towel and just clean this up a little bit. And I'm going to bring my dilutions journal in. Now the paper that's in the dilutions journal is not watercolor paper, but it's a mixed media style of paper that behaves pretty well. And I actually need to grab my remote and zoom us out a little bit too, because we are in just a little bit too tight for you to see what's going on here. Okay, so here's my journal. And I'm going to spray this. Actually, you know what? Let me grab a piece of paper and just put it under here to protect from the overspray a little bit. That'll kind of get me where I need to be. Okay, so in comes water. And again, how much water you use is really going to cause wicking and spreading or not, depending on what you do. I really like this wild lime green, so I'm going to use some of it. And I can already see that I don't have enough water on here. So you sort of want to keep an eye on that as you're playing around. In comes that wicked cool green. And again, if I'm not seeing things move the way that I would like, it's kind of a bunch of bubbles, I can come back with some more water. I'll spritz this, and cause some more bleeding. And again, I think I'm going to put some more water on here. This is a really cool process to sort of experiment and play like this and have all of these really interesting, sort of one-of-a-kind, you'll probably never create anything that looks exactly like it again, backgrounds. Again, more water, I get that really fun splatter effect, and some more bleeding going on. Maybe a little bit more of this color because I like it. Then I'll come in with some of this other blue-green color that's also really cool. Just put a drop on there. Maybe a drop over here. And again, because the paper is absorbing some of the water, I need to put some more out there. And I'm going to get really liberal with the water this time and sort of let all this go on. And I really think that this is super, super cool. Great background technique. And you get all this movement and all of this eye candy that's going on that's so cool. And if I want, I can put this to one side and let it dry, and as it does, I can also put some of the silk salt on there too to get that burst effect if I want. And of course, if I really want to play around, I can come in with my mop brush and some water, and I'll wet this quite a lot, and I'll come in and I'll let my mop brush kind of do its thing too here, and I can cause these colors to kind of bleed and spread. So I get a little bit more coverage. And the cool thing is even though I'm covering them up, those dots are not going away because they've started to dry. So that's, again, a really nice advantage to these colors. I think I'm going to put some more of the green in because I've kind of gotten away from that a little bit. And I think I'm also going to add some more water. Come back with that vivid green that's so cool. Put a little bit here. Maybe a little bit over here, and a little bit more there. And again, I'm going to add some more water, get some more bleeding, get all these fun things going on. And then, of course, I can tip this too, and we get all kinds of cool runs and drips. Perhaps one of the most interesting things I can think of to do with the acrylic inks is to use them to make sprays. Now, you're perhaps wondering what's the difference between these sprays and any other spray. Well, initially you'd think that there's probably not, but one of the basic advantages, and we come back to this, it's permanent when dry things, one of the basic advantages is that you can create these sprays, you can make them as densely colored as you want, depending on how much water to how much ink, what your proportions and ratio are. And once you put it on the page and it dries, it's not going to move. Now, obviously, there's some advantages and some disadvantages to that. If you want blending, then you don't want to do this. But if you like the notion of being able to put a background color down and let it dry and then perhaps apply another layer of color over the top of that and let it dry and then perhaps do the same thing a third time, what you get is a layering of colors with no mud. And that's a huge advantage as far as I'm concerned. I have three colors here, and I have three of the Ranger empty 2-ounce bottles. I've already got some water in the bottles, and I've labeled with a Sharpie, I've labeled the bottle with the color name. Now, you could probably spray these as they come from the bottle. I don't think it would be terribly economical to do that, but I also think that the color would be very, very intense. When I do these, I typically use a couple of full dropperfuls to each bottle. This bottle is a little bit more full than I might normally make it, so I'm probably going to use 2.5 dropperfuls. And this is one of those judgment things. How dark do you want it? How light do you want it? It's like anything else. You can easily darken it, but it's not so easy to lighten it. So play a little bit with the colors, and if yours is one that needs to be shaken, to move that pigment around in the bottle, by all means do that, because you want to be certain that you're blending the pigment as well as the acrylic base that it's suspended in. I think I'm going to go with 3 eyedropperfuls on this. Let's just see what that looks like on the yellow. You know what? I think I'm going to go with more. Even if I have to use more, this is a pretty economical way to create your own customized mists, because one of these bottles of acrylic ink will go a long way toward making spray bottles. Or spray colors, rather. Again, I'm going to use a couple of dropperfuls here. This is deep violet. It's a really nice color. I'm hoping it's going to spray as pretty as it looks. All right, let me just get my top on here. Give these a little bit of a shake and bring in my journal. Once you have sprays, you can pretty much treat these like you would any spray. So I'm going to just throw some scratch paper in here to kind of stop the overspray from getting every place. And remember, this is going to be permanent, so if you get it on your clothes, it's unlikely to wash out. In fact, it's probably not going to wash out, so just bear that in mind. I'm going to work with some warm colors. I've previously mixed up several here, so I think this is the palette I'm going to start with. And I will start with the lightest color first. So that's going to be this cadmium yellow light, and I'm just going to, oh, how pretty is that? I'm just going to apply the color kind of in a swath across the page. Then I'll come in with this orangey color. Do the same thing. And then this is quinacridone magenta. Ooh, that looks really cool. I like that a lot. That's a really cool fuchsia color. A little bit over here. And then I'm going to try some of this deep violet that I just mixed. And that's a really cool color. Really nice, deep magenta color. I think I'm going to throw a little bit down here. And then it's just a question of drying this, and you have a journal spread pretty much like any journal spread that you do. Let me dry this, and then I want to come back and show you what you can do with stencils in these sprays. One noticeable difference between using the acrylic inks mixed with water and sprayed on a page as I've done here, and for example using dilutions or color wash sprays, is that the colors that as they end up when they're dry tend to be a little bit chalkier looking. I'm sure that's just inherent to whatever it is that makes up the components of the acrylic inks. I like that look. It allows me to get a very different look than if I'm using those clear, bright colors like the dilutions or the color wash. This is just another tool in my box, as it were, that allows me to do various things when I'm creating. Now, a moment ago, we talked about the backgrounds and the fact that these backgrounds are permanent once dry. And what that means is that you cannot use the ghosting technique with these, where if I sprayed with water and the color would lift, that's not going to happen because these are permanent. So that is, if you want to think about it that way, a limitation. But again, the advantages of having permanent color are so many that I'm willing to live with that. It's okay, I can give up the ability to ghost. I can do that with plenty of other colors. I don't necessarily have to do it here. So again, I have colors now that are permanent on this page, which means they're not going to move, they're not going to change at all when I spritz more colors over the side. So let's just take, over the top rather. So let's just look at doing this, and this is the Starflower Mask Stencil. And what I'm going to do is use 3 sort of colors that are in keeping with what I've got going on here. And I also mixed up some of the iridescent copper to use to provide some glimmer, which of course makes me very happy. So again, I'm just going to give this a shake, and I'm going to come and I'm going to start misting over this mask. I'm going to come in with this deep violet and kind of do the same thing. And then I'm going to come in with the iridescent copper, and I'm going to do the same thing again. Let me just turn this around, because of course the paper's curling. This is just really inexpensive printer paper that I use to sort of mask off this area so I don't get so much overspray. And here comes the glimmer now, which of course I love. You can't go wrong with glimmer in my world. All right, so I've got that side done, and what I'm going to do now is I'm going to pick this up and turn it over, and there's a lot of liquid on this stencil. I'm hoping, well, it kind of fell where it fell, so we're going to live with it that way, and you can see what's going on here. So these sprays work with stencils and masks just as beautifully as the color wash and the dilutions do, and then of course I get this printed version of the mask, which is a real nice mirror image of what's going on the other side of this page. So stencils, all of the kinds of things that you can do with any spray, you can do with these sprays that you make yourself. And of course, you can mix them to whatever color concentration you want. You can intermix them to create custom colors. You can just do all kinds of things with them. These are dip pens. This is part of a set made by Speedball that includes these two handles and all of these nibs. Now, I am not a calligrapher, and I don't have a lot of experience with these, but I do know that all you have to do is you put the tip inside this holder and you dip it in ink, and then you're ready to write. And here's the amazing thing. As many colors of acrylic ink as you have are colors that you can actually write and make marks with one of these pens. You do need to put enough of the ink in a well like this, or you can work directly out of the mouth of the bottle, which I actually don't find convenient, but you need enough in one of these wells so that you can dip the tip of the pen in there. And bearing in mind that all you have to do to get all of that stuff out is to reverse the process and squeeze the acrylic ink out of the well and back into the bottle. So it's not like you're going to waste this. Once you're set to go, it's really just a matter of dipping your pen in the color and making your mark. Doesn't matter what you want to do, you can pretty much do it with these. You can do big swoops, you can do small swoops, you can do circles. Now again, I'm not a calligrapher. I'm sure there's better ways to do this than what I'm doing, but I bet you could tangle very easily with these. Once you've got your Zentangle and your strings in place, it would just be a question of coming in and making various marks with these. So the sky really is the limit here. Think of the lettering that you can do if you wanted, and I'm not talking about fancy calligraphy style lettering, I'm just talking about sort of your own handwriting that you can embellish. But again, with all of these colors, there's just an amazing array of things that you can do. I'm real happy that I decided to play with these acrylic inks. I think that they are versatile, there's an enormous range of colors, and they're just really fun to work with.